Today's video, we are going to be discussing everything about bilateral vestibular hypofunction or bilateral vestibular loss. So if you have been diagnosed with that condition, stay tuned. I think this video is going to be a long one. I've had a lot of people requesting information about bilateral loss, which is different than treating just one side. So make sure that you grab a snack, grab a notebook, and grab a drink, because we are going to have a long discussion about what we can do with bilateral vestibular hypofunction. First, what is bilateral loss? So the vestibular system is made up of two inner ear components, vestibular nerves. They give us our balance centers, our hearing, it talks to the brain, and that gives us our equilibrium. Bilateral loss is when we lose both of those vestibular nerves. Most of the time, unfortunately, it is idiopathic, meaning no known cause, which is super frustrating. The most common known cause of bilateral loss would be ototoxicity, or some medication, chemical substance that is toxic to the ear. This most commonly would be gentamicin, which is a very strong antibiotic. Commonly, if you have MRSA or if you've been in the hospital, administered IV antibiotics. Anything with a myosin at the end, I would be concerned that that is an ototoxic antibiotic. Gentamicin, kinomycin, streptomycin, and a few others. So if you have had that administered in your history and you develop dizziness right after, that may have been the cause of your bilateral loss. Other possible causes could include Meniere's disease, cochlear implantation or post-surgical, meningitis, or autoimmune disease. So now that we covered the causes, how is the presentation different? How is that different than unilateral hypofunction? I would say the biggest marker is that you're not going to have as much vertigo as you have unsteadiness, walking, like you're veering or swaying all over the place. Oscillopsia is a huge marker. And if you haven't seen my videos on oscillopsia, that just means a bouncy vision. So at rest, your vision looks clear, but as soon as you walk and your vestibular system is meant to be activated, we lose that gaze stability and your eyes kind of are bouncing when you walk, and that's oscillopsia. You're also going to notice that you have much more severe imbalance in the dark or with less visual cues. And the alternative is, because you don't have a good vestibular system, if you are in busy crowds, casinos, airports, visually complex places, and your eyes are taking over, you may actually have a different kind of dizziness from visually busy places as well, more so than unilateral hypofunction. Another common cause of bilateral loss would be CANVAS syndrome, which is an inherited genetic disorder, which involves cerebellar ataxia, neuropathy in both feet, so a lack of sensation in both feet, and then vestibular areflexia, which means that you have bilateral vestibular loss. So that should be identified by a neurologist. So now that we know the causes of bilateral hypofunction, we know how it presents differently. Now we're going to talk about treatment approaches, which are different and unique to themselves. First, I want to make sure to let you know that the recovery from bilateral loss is harder than just losing one side. You are going to have a harder time with your exercises. You're going to need to dose or do them longer throughout your day. You are definitely going to be doing them lifelong, and the recovery time for max benefits is actually in the neighborhood of 3 months, versus with hypofunction, you're going to see a lot of those benefits in the first 4 to 6 weeks. I just want you to make sure that your expectations are long-term. You are going to have to be doing your vestibular therapy for 3 months or longer to get those max benefits. Because the human balance system is composed of three parts: the vestibular system, the ocular or vision system, and your somatosensory or your touch system. That is how I base my approach to treatment. We are going to try to do vestibular exercises to improve any function or any reflex that we have between the VOR, or the vestibular ocular reflex. So that inner ear to the brain, eyes balance. The second approach is your vision. We are going to be doing eye exercises. Those serve as a substitution for the lack of inner ear strength. And lastly, the biggest component is probably going to be balance and grounding. So if you can't count on the vestibular system, we need to make up for it with vision, which can be tricky, or we need to make up for it with somatosensory. So it's almost like we are pretending that we don't have a visual or vestibular system, and we are really focusing on our ground, what we touch and feel. So with that being said, let's get started on the vestibular exercises. So the gaze stability exercises that we do are the foundation of vestibular rehab. What they are meant to do is improve that reflex between the inner ear, brain, eye, and then balance complex. So if there's any function of the inner ear, we want to make sure we preserve and maintain that. Your gaze stability exercises. I have some great videos on gaze stability if you would like to look at those further. They are right here in this video above. Otherwise, we are gonna go through a few of my favorite gaze stability exercises, and make sure that you grab my free download on gaze stability progression. It is very important that you start at a progression that suits you best. So we are gonna start our exercises in seated, but very commonly, I would have you progress to standing, foam pad, walking, and then outside. But today, we start in seated. So the first one I'm going to demo is VOR times one, or VOR near, if you're reading along with my gaze stability checklist. So we have our stick here with our X on it. What you need to do is move your head as fast as you can while keeping your eyes on that X without it blurring. That is the most important part. If it is blurring, you slow down. Your goal is to complete each of these exercises for 1 minute to tolerance. On a 0 to 10 scale, your dizziness should only increase by 2 to 3 points, and it should quickly subside. There is no harm in breaking up your exercises and doing one at a time or all at once, whatever suits you and whatever makes you feel comfortable. So VOR times one looks like this. We have our stick. I'm going to look at my X and shake my head back forth as quickly as I can. Bump, 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 back forth, back forth, back forth, keeping my eyes on that target. My goal is to get to a minute. I wait for any dizziness to go away. I will complete up and down. So that looks more like a bobblehead. Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. So it's small and it's quick. Now, if this was smearing or blurring all over the place, I would slow my beat down and I might go up, down, up, down, up, down. The main thing is that we keep that image clear. So next is VOR times two. We take our stick, and what you're going to do is move your stick and your head opposite of one another. And it goes like this, opposite, 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 back, forth, back, forth, back, forth, times 1 minute. And then up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, times 1 minute. Next exercise is going to be VOR far. So what that looks like, I'm picking an object across the room, maybe a light switch, a doorknob, something small. I'm going to do my head shakes back forth times 1 minute, up, down times 1 minute. The next exercise I will have you do is imaginary VOR. Basically, you are going to close your eyes, turn your head, open your eyes onto the target. Close, turn, open. Close, turn, open. Times 30 to 60 seconds, and then repeat up and down. So close, turn, open. Close, turn, open. So the next exercise I want you to do is eye, then head. Make sure you vary the speeds with your neck motions and try to keep your eyes locked onto that target. So we move our eyes, then our head. Eyes, then our head. Eyes, head. And I can vary my speed if I can't keep my eyes on that target. But remember, the vestibular system is more active when you move your head quicker. So try to increase your speed if you can keep your eyes on that target. Now remember, that gaze stability program is going to be lifelong. So I want you to do these at least 5 days a week in the beginning of your program, and then minimum 2 to 3 for maintenance after you feel like you've reached your plateau so you don't lose anything. All right, next we are gonna go on to phase two, which is substitution. So if those vestibular exercises aren't working and there is no preservation of the vestibular nerve, we are going to use the eyes to substitute for that inner ear loss. So we are actually going to do eye tracking in this instance. So I want you to keep your eyes on your stick, make a very conscious effort of not losing it, and you're going to increase your speed to make sure that if you move faster, your eyes can keep up. So it's substitution for that quick move that the ear should be responsible. You'll do 10 left and right, 10 up and down, always keeping your eyes on track, and then 10 diagonal. Now, if you have visual dizziness and the background bothers you, start with a blank background and then work your way up to a busier background. Try to ignore that background and focus on your seat in the chair and just keeping your eyes on track, trying to ignore that visual stimulus in the background. Next, I'm going to show you two saccade exercises. Now, these are just eye move to target, basically. When the inner ear can't function, we are going to use those saccades to substitute for that. I have a multitude of progression for saccades. We are going to start with basics here, though. So all you need is two targets. You can hold them in your hand, or you could pick two targets in your room. So I need you to just move your eyes to the target, back and forth times 10, at different planes of motion, up, down, diagonals. Mainly, you are focusing on the fact that you are spotting, and you can get that correctly each time. Okay, so 10 each plane of motion. Now we're gonna add the eyes and the head movement together with that. So I want you to move and spot. Move together and spot. When that inner ear is sluggish, you're gonna feel like it smears a little bit or blurs, so slow down until you can successfully keep your eyes on that target when you move your head. We'll do up, we'll do down. And we can do our diagonals, but make sure you spot and lock your eyes onto target each time. So hopefully you saw the difference between those. The first is just eye movement, and the second is adding head and eye movement together. Next, I want you to grab a ball. Maybe it's a tennis ball, lacrosse ball. Anything with hand-eye coordination is good. You could take a tennis ball and throw it up against the wall. You could take the lacrosse ball and track it as you're tossing it to yourself. You can be quite creative with this, but the gist of it is 60 seconds of doing hand-eye coordination exercises. That could even be hitting a volleyball or just getting out in the backyard and throwing a ball around. Basically, anything to work that hand-eye coordination with head motion as well. Last exercise that I want you to focus on, even though I probably have about 45 others, is TikTok or CVOR. So you're gonna take your stick or your pencil and I want you to move everything together. Again, if this is visually stimulating, please ignore the background and focus on your body in that chair or standing balance. But I'm gonna have you do 60 seconds back and forth, keeping your eyes on that target. If it is too dizzying, blank background and then work to a busy background. The third treatment approach is going to be balance and grounding, which is probably the most important. With bilateral vestibular loss, you are going to feel better when you have more contact points with the earth. What do I mean by that? If you are outside and using walking poles or a walker, you're going to notice that your oscillopsia is less, your balance is better. So if you need to use a walking pole or a rollator or walker, if you do need that. Otherwise, I need you to focus on your balance and your grounding so you don't need an assisted device at all or at any time. So some examples of balance exercises are my clock exercise, where I want you to picture your feet like a clock in standing, and you're going to sway your body forward, hold it, sway your body backwards, hold it, and then find the middle of your foot. You're going to repeat that 4 to 5 times with eyes open and eyes closed, testing your stability and trying to keep your balance in the middle and from falling. Also repeat that in your 9 to 3. So again, picture your feet like a clock and purposely sway to 12, 6, middle, 9, 3, middle. Do that with eyes open and eyes closed. That is my foundation for balance, because anything else that you do, you are always going to try to find the middle of your clock. When you take a step, when you feel unsteady, I want you to try to focus in on the middle of that foot, and do you feel like you're steady on the ground? Try to ignore your visual input. We are lacking the vestibular input, so we are kind of walking blind in a sense, where we really want to focus on what the earth is providing us and what our feet feel. Am I steady? Other balance exercises include bending forward on the floor or foam pad while trying to maintain your balance, doing diagonal reaches from the floor or foam pad, turns in the corner while trying to ignore that dizziness and maintaining our balance in the center of our foot, heel to toe standing for 30 to 60 seconds, standing on one leg for 30 to 60 seconds, or simply standing with our feet together on the floor or foam pad, and maybe even adding a head turn and trying not to fall, and just being very mindful of keeping that center of our foot and being very grounded with our stability. So hopefully you found this helpful. If you need further explanation and one-on-one help, I'll make sure to also throw my vestibular coaching program down in the comments below so you can learn a little bit more. I know I gave you a ton of information. I hope this is helpful for your journey in recovering from bilateral vestibular loss. Please let me know in the comments below if you have any questions or if you have found this helpful. I always look forward to hearing your thoughts and if you have any other ideas for videos that you would like help with. So until I see you next week, stay healthy, stay strong, and stay steady.